Hi, LA progressive readers and friends. We're back again with Mark Fancher, who writes occasionally for us, regularly for us, as appeared on a recent video. He's a prolific author and attorney of some deep experience. Welcome, Mark. Good to see you again.
Hi, Mark. Oh,
no, thank you so much. It's good to see you as well.
So, there's a lot of excitement this week in Chicago. For people who follow politics, it appears that there's a chance we won't have to have a dreadful reprise of Trump. We won't have to put up with any more angry harangues from Joe Biden. There's a chance that the first Black Indian woman will become president. But as you point out in a recent article, Mission Impossible for Kamala Harris, Save a Crumbling Empire, that really, to the puppet masters, the wealthy puppet masters, the elite, it really won't make any difference. That no matter where Kamala Harris' heart and head is, she won't be able to dent the control of the country. Is that right?
Yes, that's right. And, you know, as wonderful as it will hopefully be not to have to endure another Trump administration, the problem is when people begin to believe that defeating Trump equals a revolution. Right. And it doesn't. It just means that you've got an opportunity not to have to endure another 4 years of an idiotic, obnoxious, individual. But in terms of the challenges that confront the world, those are still there. And in some cases, the Democratic Party poses an even greater threat to the independence and self-determination and longing for freedom that the masses of the people throughout the world desperately crave.
That's right. You know, you talk about the problem that we have is that we don't have a democracy. We have an oligarchy. And Dick and I frequently talk about a study that was published by Princeton University and Northwestern University professors who did a two-decade study where they investigated a couple of thousands of pieces of policy and then compared the policies that were written by legislators with what their constituents said they wanted. And they found that 9 times out of 10, what their constituents wanted was not at all reflected in the policy, and that what was reflected was the interests of the deep-pocketed corporations and individuals. And so you talk about an oligarchy that's oligarchy that's comprised of wealthy individuals and their families, large corporations, and quasi-criminal syndicates that lurk in the shadows, buying, trading, and controlling our politicians. Can you talk a little bit more? I guess my question kind of laid it all bare, but talk about how you see that.
Yeah, it is not as though there are these sinister guys sitting in a back room smoking cigars, plotting who's going to do what and how they're going to do it. But effectively and functionally, you get that kind of a result. You have an idealistic politician who goes into electoral politics full of hopes and dreams about how they're going to reform the world. And immediately they run into certain political realities that they're told that you're not going to be able to make a difference as soon as you get in. You're going to have to get some experience. You're going to have to form relationships. You're going to have to get a certain amount of seniority before you get choice assignments to do this or to be on that committee or to do this or the other thing. And the only way that you can do that is to stay in office. And so if you're running for, if you're in the House of Representatives and you've run for, you've got a 2-year term, you've got to start running again almost as soon as you've been in. And you've already spent a huge amount of money just to get the seat. And now you need more money to run, to start another campaign. And where are you going to get it? You're going to get it from deep pockets. And the money that they donate comes with strings. It's, well, yeah, okay, I'll donate. But, we really would like to see some action on this legislation. We'd like to see it happen this way or happen that way. And so they end up playing the game. They end up listening to people who are making donations. They end up listening to more influential and powerful people within the legislative structure that they're in, and taking their advice about how to maneuver, who to make deals with, who to establish relationships with. And before you know it, they've been transformed into these, you know, individuals who basically are following the lead and the directions of people who are not necessarily their constituents. Sometimes there's a correlation between the two, but if there is any conflict, then certainly the money wins. And, you know, the higher you go, the more direct the impact and the influence. You know, someone who's a president of the United States is confronted with very real realities about their circumstances. And I don't know this, but my guess is that their marching orders are laid out to them very bluntly and in the most stark terms. You know, I never will forget how during his campaign, Barack Obama was all smiles. But there was a certain meeting that he had, I believe, with the heads of the military establishment and the intelligence agencies. And he came out of that ashen. He looked like he was visibly shaking. And I just assumed that it was because of the things that he had been told about what he was going to be expected to do as president of the United States. And these things are not very nice things. These are orders to engage in ongoing killing. You know, the suppression of political voices and the political will of communities and nations around the world. Making available to large corporations opportunities to move at will across state borders and to eliminate any threats to their ability to operate. And it's always framed in terms that make it sound as though it's for the greater good, that these may seem like brutal actions that we're taking. These may seem like barbaric actions that we're taking, but this is what's necessary in order for us to preserve the security of the United States. This is what we have to do. And so people fall into that, and the oligarchy always gets its way.
You point out a few examples, though, in the global South, where the oligarchy is getting served its lunch, perhaps, finally, in the Sahel. Burkina Faso, Mali, and Niger have formed an alliance and are chasing out the French and American troops, the influence. And in Haiti, even though our mainstream media calls it lawless gangs and criminal gangs, there is actually a revolutionary force looking to overthrow a corrupt oligarchy government. And similarly in Venezuela, the mainstream media says Maduro stole an election, but people on the ground report that he is wildly popular. So it's hard to see how that transfers to the United States, but it's good to hear that, as you say, the oligarchy is losing its grip some places.
It is, and the encouraging thing is that once the level of consciousness among masses of people grows, it's hard to reverse that, and I'm not even sure that you can. You know, one example that I frequently talk about is back in the 1950s, the 1960s, in the earliest years of the civil rights movement, there were many in the civil rights movement who believed that the resistance that they were getting by Southern white bigots could and should be countered by the federal government. That if you could get the FBI to come down and to intervene in those situations, that the demonstrators would be protected. And they actually turned to the FBI to try and do that. But fast forward, you know, the world has come to know the role that the FBI played in all of that, sometimes working against the demonstrators. And then, you know, as you move forward into the era of the Black Power movement and the anti-war movement, and the crimes that were committed by the FBI in the counterintelligence program or COINTELPRO, and all of this stuff comes to light, it would be very difficult now to find an activist with his head screwed on straight who would think that the FBI would be an ally or a friend in any progressive movement. And you can't erase that. People know it. And I think in the same way around the world, people are beginning to understand the dynamic, the relationship that exists between Western superpowers and the underdeveloped countries in the Southern Hemisphere, and the way that historically these countries and private multinational corporations and others have exploited these countries, have looted their resources, have pitted factions of communities against each other, have assassinated leaders. All of these crimes are now known. And so even when you have situations such as in the Sahel or in Haiti or other places where you don't have necessarily a well-developed revolutionary movement or organization that has an ideology and disciplined cadre and a structure, where you don't have all of that, what you do have is an intuitive knowledge and an understanding of the nature of imperialism and how it works against the people in these countries. And so that when they find themselves in a situation to challenge it, they know exactly who their enemies are. And they deal with them as though they're enemies. It's quite different from in the past when, someone who would seize power in a country would immediately look to ways in which they could preserve their power and would be willing to sell their souls to the West and to say, you help keep me in power, I'll make my country available to you to loot in any way that you want.
So I'm always interested in opportunities to remove imperialist presence in a country. And then the country seems to embrace those same imperialist type or fascist type activities. One thing I've been watching is the growth of BRICS. Now, I know that that's just an organization, a loose alliance of countries, Brazil, Russia, India, China, South America, and now several other countries have joined BRICS for economic power. But my concern is they may be wanting to get rid of a certain kind of imperial power only to replace it with another. Do you have those same concerns?
Well, only to a certain extent, and I've not necessarily looked at BRICS specifically, but what we do know historically is that very often the expressed desire to displace an oppressor does not always translate into a desire to eliminate oppression.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes it means I just want to trade places.
Yes.
I don't like this oppressor because it's not me. I want to be the oppressor.
Yeah, right? That's you worded what I was attempting to. You worded it much better than I would have, because I looked domestically at some of the Black and brown faces in high places here in the United States. We could never have imagined that a Black woman or a Black man would become president of the United States. But the material changes in our lives, that never happened. The kinds of oppression that when we look at racism and discrimination and employment and housing and healthcare, all of those things still exist as they have always existed. And in some ways, things are worse. So.
Yeah. Frantz Fanon warned about it, in a colonial context, and he called it the pitfalls of nationalism. So that in a colonial situation where you've got all of this anti-colonial sentiment and everybody is rallying around the nationalist flag, we've got to get the colonizers out. We've got to get the colonizers out. He warned that you got to look at the individuals. Some of the individuals are saying, let's get the colonizers out so that I can become the new colonial puppet, mm-hmm. So that nationalism will take you only so far. You might join forces with everyone in staging an attack on the external force of the oppressor. But the question is, are you also opposed to the system that the oppressor has been committed to? Are you willing to eliminate that as well? If you're not, then it's very likely that all that you want to do is to preserve the system so that you can be the one that's the boss of it.
So, related very much to this week and the current election, are Our puppet masters are very insistent that we continue to support the Zionist genocide in Palestine, even though the bulk of Americans are at least alarmed and outraged. Do you think anything could ever be done to change that situation?
I think it's a process, and we're seeing it unfold. I think that actually the level of awareness about the crimes of Zionism is higher than I could have dreamed a few years ago. But the clever response by those who have an interest in preserving Zionism has been to pivot very quickly away from the idea that Zionism is the problem, to the idea that we have an aberration in terms of a genocide that's happening under the Zionist umbrella, that that what we have to do is just get a ceasefire. We need to stop the killing. And once we stop the killing, then we can go back to business as usual. Everything will be fine again, without understanding that the genocide is the product of a Zionist philosophy and a system that is certain to recur unless you remove the entire thing root and branch. And so we're not at that point yet. At this point, you have so many well-meaning Democrats who are thrilled that Kamala Harris is going to be the president because she's said some things that sound promising in terms of pursuing a quote-unquote ceasefire. But what she has also said is that she's a committed Zionist, that she remembers as a child planting trees for Israel, and that she's committed to the Israeli state. So we're just going to have to, you know, continue to try and make as clear as we can the fact that what we're witnessing in the way of the violence is just the product of a system that is designed to operate in a violent way all the time.
Yeah, yeah. You mentioned the discovery of oil in Gaza, and I looked it up and found that it was just discovered in 2000. This mass reserves, 1 trillion cubic feet of natural gas discovered off the coast of Gaza. And no doubt plays a role in what we're seeing play out today.
Oh yeah, yeah. I mean, I'm not an authority on Palestine, but from what I understand, the Palestinian population was placed in Gaza in the first place because they thought that that was some of the worst territory. That was something that the Israeli state would have no need for. So that's their little Bantustan. Put them there. And then they felt, oh my goodness, we put them in a place that we really want and we really need, and we need to get rid of them. And the U.S. has historically been very shrewd. You know, they are real weasels. You know, they have always done lots of dirty work around the world, but always have just done it in such a way that they can raise their hands and say, see, our hands are clean. We didn't do it. Somebody else did it. And so they operate through the use of proxies. And Israel has been one of their best proxies. And so the Israeli Defense Forces campaign of genocide is one that the empire has been, you know, probably very happy to see because it's removing a population from a territory that they really want access to. And there are all kinds of additional benefits to it. I mean, not only do they get the population out of the way, but they destroy the region's infrastructure and all of its buildings and everything else. They just destroy everything so that once the population is safely removed, then they can have these trillion-dollar contracts that go to contractors and other corporations to engage in disaster capitalism. You know, they can make trillions of dollars going in to rebuild things in Gaza, as well as take advantage of the natural resources that are there and the other opportunities for commercial development. So it works out really well.
So you point to the three revolutions or movements in the Sahel and Venezuela and Haiti Do you have any thoughts on their chance of, number one, of succeeding, and number of two, encouraging other places to follow suit?
I think that the story has not been fully written in any of those places yet, and we're going to have to wait and see. I'm not of a mind that, particularly in the Sahel and in Haiti, that these are going to result in any types of new revolutionary governments. I think that those who are involved probably lack the discipline and the organization that's necessary to bring about a full-scale revolution. And also, that's just not the way revolutions generally happen. Revolutions generally happen when the broad masses of people are responsible for it. I think the broad masses of people may be sympathetic to what these people are doing, but they're not necessarily actively engaged in an organized way. But what the benefit is that number one, it does demonstrate how the empire can be resisted and in some cases defeated. That provides a source of inspiration to people who are on the ground trying to organize genuine revolution. And I also think that it demonstrates in a real way the value of unity and the power of it. You know, you have three countries in the Sahel, Niger, Mali, Burkina Faso, who just these three countries who pledged to support each other and to stand with each other against any types of attacks by the West have been able to push them out and fend them off, at least for the moment. And so that fires the imagination. That says that if three countries can do that, imagine what we can do with 54. You know, an entire continent that has pledged to preserve Africa's independence and its autonomy and to exercise its legitimate right to self-determination, and it's willing to fight off anybody that comes in and tries to do that. I mean, that is of very high value. And so while the war may not be won in these skirmishes, I think that it's an important piece of the history that's being written for Africa's revolution. And likewise in Haiti, where you have what they continue to describe as quote unquote gangs, and it's not clear that that's necessarily an accurate description of who they are. What there does seem to be agreement about is that there are a number of different of these formations, and that they too have come together and have in a unified way been able to fend off the external forces that have come in to try and suppress them. And, you know, they even brought in the Kenyan troops, and you've got Canadians and you've got U.S. people in there trying, and they failed. They have not been able to get control of Haiti and in the face of the resistance that they're meeting. And there are lessons there, too, about the value of a unified front. So these are important things. And, you know, certainly in Venezuela, you know, the attacks by the U.S. on that country have been sustained and ongoing for years, you know, since, you know, Hugo Chavez was there. And even, you know, with everything that's been done to try and to, you know, bring down the efforts that are underway there, the U.S. has failed. So all of these things are important developments. It gives inspiration and hope, I think, to people who do want to see a change in the balance of power in the world.
Do you think with the change of balance of power in the world, we'll see a change in the way that capitalism is implemented, or perhaps even the elimination of capitalism?
No, I think that we're looking at the prospect of it being eliminated. I think intellectually it's making less and less sense to people as they look at it. So you have that. I mean, even here in the U.S., you know, it used to be that if you were a socialist, you had to whisper that. You know, it was like, you know, not because you were necessarily afraid of any type of direct reprisals for it, but you were afraid that people would think that you're some kind of weirdo, or, you know, you're insane or something like that. You mentioned it now, before, college age kids and things like that. They're like, they shrug their shoulders like, well, isn't everybody a socialist? I mean, it's like, people understand the contradictions of capitalism. And I think that capitalists themselves are becoming more aware of this level of consciousness, and they've become more desperate in their attempts to try and preserve the power that they have through the maintenance of that system. But I think if we get to a point where we do have large blocks of nations, I mentioned a unified African continent, just, that's really sort of the essence of what Pan-Africanism is all about. If Africa were unified and socialist, then imagine the possibilities, not just for Africa, but for everybody struggling for socialism around the world. So often these struggles are done in isolation and with no resources. Now you've got the premier superpower on the planet saying, we endorse what these people are doing. And anybody that's resisting their efforts to implement a socialist program is going to have to deal with us. That offers incredible possibilities and opportunities. And it boggles the imagination because we can see, even in our experience, the impact of even someplace like a tiny little, island like Cuba, and the impact that it has had on socialist struggles throughout the hemisphere and throughout the world. And that's just a tiny little island. People don't know the full story, but people celebrate the elimination of political apartheid in South Africa. People are unaware of the critical role that Fidel Castro and the Cubans played in negotiating the release of Nelson Mandela and ushering in the end of apartheid as we had come to know it, just by virtue of their having been present physically with their soldiers, in Angola. And putting so much pressure on the apartheid regime, in and through Namibia, and forcing the apartheid regime and the US to the negotiating table to basically say, what do you want in order for us to get your soldiers out of this region? You're killing us. And they negotiated the terms. They said, you're going to get Mandela out, we're going to move for the independence of Namibia, and you're going to start deconstructing this apartheid thing. And they said, you're going to do that. And they said, we'll do it. And if you do, and if you do it, will you take your soldiers out? And they said, yeah, we'll take our soldiers out. And so the Cubans lived up to their promise. They rounded up all of the Cuban troops that they had. They put them on a plane and they took them back to Cuba. They emptied the plane out and they filled the plane with doctors and flew them right back into Africa. And they said, you didn't say anything about us bringing doctors in. And the Cubans, since that time, have provided medical assistance and doctors to countries throughout Africa at a level that no other country has. It's these are stories that really are just phenomenal. And we see the power of just one little country. Imagine what an entire continent can and will do.
Wow. Well, Mark Francher, that's a great story to end this interview on. These kinds of stories, no doubt, are suppressed. Here in the United States, we never hear anything positive about the major contributions Cuba has made to the world. So thank you, Mark, for sharing that and for sharing your knowledge and all of the articles that you allow us to publish with the LA Progressive.
And if
Well,
you're up to it, that story about Cuba's involvement over the decades in Africa would be a wonderful article.
yes, it would be.
Well, I would have be happy to write it. It's not original with me. There's an excellent documentary that the Cuban government put out that documents its entire involvement in Africa, which is magnificent, and it tells that story and others. I'm so grateful that you provide a platform for ideas that we're not going to get anywhere else. And I appreciate the work that you do.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. Thank
So
you very
long.
much.
Bye-bye.
Thank you for sticking around. If you like the LA Progressive content and the discussions we have here, please consider clicking the subscribe button below. And also, give us a thumbs up. That helps to grow our audience by feeding the algorithm, which helps to get this content in front of more eyes. Thanks for stopping by. We really appreciate your support.